microphone. Hopefully it will work. So, yes.
Okay, one link was wrong. I'll try to fix it as soon as possible. So should we start here? So what I mean is the search for homologs, of course, it's like when you search for homologs in so the whole idea of homology modeling is basically you want to copy the coordinate from a known structure to your sequence. So basically that's that. And as I said before, it's common that, in general, homologous sequences have a similar structure. So the more similar the sequences are, the more similar the structure. So what you do is, of course, doing your sequence searching. You find homology, you find sequences, you have an alignment, and that is where you start with when you do homology modeling. And of course, we know also that it is much better to use multiple sequence alignments than using cyblast. I mean, the reason it's that blast are faster is because it's an old slide that set up. On the other hand, if you really have good sequence identity, it doesn't matter. So you find the same hit, you find the same alignment. If you have 30, 40, 50% sequence identity, where you do it most of the time, you will find the same hit and the same alignment, no matter what method you use, basically. But certainly, there has been quite a lot of work on improving homology modeling. And basically, all this work has been done on getting better alignment. I mean, that's the only, there's a lot of other work also, but the only thing that really has mattered is to get a better alignment. So it's really been finding the best template, sometimes finding multiple templates, and getting the best possible alignment. That's really been the work that's been pushing the limits in the last decades. And then this modeling procedure, as I tried to describe earlier, these are two different methods that are kind of wide used, and there are several implementations of this. And I think even I talked a bit at the end about some benchmark we did some years ago for different methods. And a little bit of what I described here is kind of the old-fashioned things we do one step at a time. So there used to be, there still are programs like this Swiss modeler. You can really do things, you can model one loop at a time, one thing at a time, etc. Nowadays, really the most well-used program is probably modeler that really does not work in this way. You really try to model the whole structure at once. Basically, it takes all the constraints from the alignments and then it folds the structure up together. And it's not that it's significantly better than other methods, but it's quite robust. It's has quite a lot of options if you want to play around with alternative things, and it's not significantly worse than anything else either. So it's like, in most cases, you probably do equally well using more of this hierarchical method than you do with modeler. But it's very simple to use, and it's fast. It takes a minute or two to run it. You put it on your, you run, you press in your alignment, and you push a button, and you run it. So this iteration, otherwise, it really depends on, it's much more manual work, and we do hardly ever do it. We don't iterate at all, but of course, that's because we don't really care so much. I mean, we try to do large scale, and we don't have time to look at every model, and try to do programmatic. But if the people are really wanting to study one protein very, very carefully, and want to have the best model, they certainly iterate many things, and try different things, and to look at it, what happens if it is a stable MV, if you show different models, etc. But that's really if you want to sit down and look at one model. I mean, if you really want to be sure that you have the best possible model. And I'm not sure that really that even your manual judgment that really improves things, because it's mean, you can see the things that are unstable and try to fix it, but it's in general these automatic methods like model does things pretty good. Let's see, find a slide. Most crucial point of alignment. It happened in the title. Oh, I don't find this page. But somewhere. I wonder what this slide was to do with people asking for.
These are some other slides, right?
Maybe that explains it. Maybe it's this one, sir. You're probably correct. Yeah. So basically, what I meant with this slide was that basically, man, the most crucial part of a homology model procedure is to get the alignment right. So, I mean, basically, if you have the alignment wrong, it's very, very difficult to fix it, have any computer program fix this. So, this example is just an example, it's a toy example, but think about it, you have these two sequences, and you have an application is yellow residue. So, of course, the alignment is trivial, but you don't know if you align this one here or this one here, it's the same. I mean, where do you put the gap? I mean, all the alignment problems come for gaps. Where do you put the gaps? And if you have a structure, if it looks like that, if you put a gap in this position here instead, you're going to have to try to fit it like that, because you're going to try to align. When you start modeling, we have one extra residue here. If you, on the other hand, instead of putting the gap that is here instead, you would just have made this loop 3 residues long instead of making 2 residues long, and it would be much easier. So that is like, and this is one of the things like, if you really have a program that depends on your alignment, which they all do somehow, this type of errors, maybe not with that, but there'll be some disturbances out there that are not ideal. And this is really structure information that you don't have if you look at just a sequence alignment. If you do a proofful alignment, you might have that, because maybe you see that there are many more gaps in this position, and that position is going to have a good cut W or something, would put the gap in the right position. But if you have just a template, or you have a single alignment, you could, you know, and from a sequence point of view, this is equivalent, but from a study perspective, it's much better to shift them one step here, which is what is to align the model. Yes. Why? Because this is a toy model, but if you think, this is starting to beat the heat, this is a loop. So, and this thing here, you could look at that, you would have to go out like this somehow, and you couldn't really chemically form it like that. So you would have to have, so basically it would be some disturbances here. And, but even the other, if you had this one here, you can make a loop to these three things like that, that's much easier. Because most of the structure variation are in the loop and flexibility is in the loop regions. You got it? So this is it looks nice here, but this is a toy project. This is another example of the same thing. It's actually really modern. So here you can think about two alignments, the red or blue, to the template, the green. So the green is template is bigger, so you lost 2 residues. And you can either put, from a sequence point of view, you would like to align the programs to each other. They are identical, but 3 are in loops, and maybe that's good, but you have 3 gaps. But here you have nothing that's identical. You align allele pruning, which is bad, and here in 3 is maybe slightly better, but they are not obvious that this alignment is better. But if you look at structure, Yeah, the green structure goes like that. So if you use the red alignment, you will basically have this residue and this residue needed close. It's a long distance. So that means, of course, when you want to close this, they should be next to each other in the 3D measure coordinates. So if you need to close them, you need to make a lot of changes. And most likely you do something wrong when you make all the changes. So then it's most likely you're not going to get an optimal model. On the other hand, if you put this blue alignment, it will bring these two points together in a much closer space. It will be much easier.
So let's say you're trying to create this blue alignment. Then for the gap part, do you put in random stuff, random amino acids, or do you...
In this case, this one should be on top of that one. That's the beginning of this rest.
Okay.
So in this case, it's not an insertion, it's a deletion. If you put in, if you would like to model the green one and the blue instead, if you think the other way around, you would put in these three amino acids. But that would be maybe easier if you started with the red alignment, because you would have more space to put them in. But certainly, the three-dimensional coordinates contain information that is. Could be used to improve an alignment. I mean, for a while, people are using a lot of structure information, gaps that depend on the structures, length, and things like that. I don't think anybody really does now, because the reason is because actually, if you use proof alignments, if you use multiple sequence alignments, a lot of this information comes naturally from the multiple sequence alignment.
Is that always possible, or is it common that you have constraints if you try to close something like that when you try to make the model? I mean,
yes, this is what the program has to overcome. So, if you have too much constraints, you basically cannot make a good model.
Yeah.
I mean, that depends on what program you're using, what type of errors you got. If you use model that happens, it basically you got things that are not sticks out the wrong ways, and you have no information, and you get high energy, so it basically doesn't look nice. Other programs make other type of errors, maybe. I mean, normally, you don't try to overpack things, but you have bad phi psi angles, all the chemistry become bad.
Mm.
So that's almost, it's always a balance between, you can still make models, just copy it, but then of course, no bond will be 10 angstroms, because that's chemically impossible.
But are there programs that try to compensate for that and try to...
Yes, that is what all these programs do, basically. Basically, that's what you do when you do the modeling, is basically trying to compensate for these things. Yeah. I mean, if it's just copying, that's trivial. So if you go through what this program does, basically, even if you start, start here. So Swiss model, which is, I think it's still used, I don't use it anymore, but I think it still exists around. So basically what you do is a very traditional classical way of doing whole modeling. You copy the backbone, that's just copy coordinates, and you ignore it. You're going to have things that are chemically impossible. You're going to have a big gap that are 10 angstroms into residues next to each other. Or you're going to have 10 residues in the same place. And actually what you do is, then you copy the side chains. It's not alive.
Yeah,
it works. Okay. So you copy the side chains. So basically that's most likely, if the side chains are, if you have the same side chain, the similar side chain, most likely look the same, so better copy this one. So you basically copy as much as you can. And then you build the loops, because most of the gaps are going to be in loops. So everything will have a gap or insertion, you build it. And you do this using, this kind of fragments, you basically try to put things together. You can do database searches, which you try to basically take your database. You try to find all other PDB files that have these two anchor points at a certain distance and a certain angles, and then having this number of residues in between them. So you try to look for random fragments. Yes.
One question: why do you find a 9 residue fragment, but when you only have 5 residue inside?
Because often you want to take the 2 residues before and after, because you have some anchor points.
Mm-hmm.
So you have 5 residues here, but you want them to fit nicely to be in the end. So you don't want to have something that fits perfectly here, but has completely wrong angles in the anchor points. So that's why you include a couple of residues on each side. So that's how, by in this case, you have 9, but people do different things. But you want it, it's not just this part should fit, it should fit to the others.
So it's two like the default number for each
right, if it, but two you have it basically. You have the orientation. If you have only one, you still have the moment, the direction. So two atoms of force basically you have vectors as anchored more or less. And of course, you allow some flexibility and so on. But these are things that are details that the programs are optimized. And basically, the problem with fragments is that if you have long loops, they don't exist in the database. So really, I mean, it's because it's just not enough examples. But 9 you can probably do, maybe 10, 11, but not much longer. If it's very long, you basically need to do what we talk about next week when we do contact ab initio folding. So basically, yeah, so you do these things. But from alignment, you do the structure modeling. So you know the thing. I mean, this is just programs you can do, and you can do it one over time, all at the same time, and you can try to change something. But basically, you are trying to solve this conflict between chemical correctness and copying templates. You have to fix the gaps and that. And you don't want two atoms on top of each other. But like Johanna talked about yesterday, you want to have the side chain angles in the right orientation. And you want to have it look as much as possible like a good protein structure. And 20 years ago, the programs were pretty bad, but nowadays, programs are pretty good. So, programs are almost too good, so you basically can take a wrong alignment and make the protein look okay anyhow in many aspects. It's just optimize the chemistry. So you get out kind of outputs that doesn't just because that it's not that difficult to make something that's chemically correct. So even if you have a completely wrong model, you can look things that actually look like cell sheets. So there are examples of proteins that are built. I mean, I think I'm built on a beta sheet structure, and many aspects that look okay. I mean, if you have to build one from That's where we'll talk about it later, but there are methods to do it, but it's not the chemistry itself, like bond angle, bond angle, it's not very good at separating the things. But anyway, there could be some implications. You have to output, this is not problem, this is probably just templates. You can make a model, you can look at where things are bound, you can look at actually with the Swiss model, it's a whole workflow, so you can actually modify things. Okay, what happens if I shift it? And here you have one target, you have actually 5 different templates, you can model using this one, I can choose which one I want to use. I can play around where I have this gap over here and move it around. But you see that most cases it's not, this modeling is quite simple, it's hardly. There's one gap here and one gap here, basically. So in this kind of, I don't know, single entity, but it's probably 40% or something. The alignment is not that difficult, but it can be crucial. It could be really bad if you move this alignment one step, one way or another. And of course, you only care about it mainly if it is, assuming that you want to make model and then you want to design a new drug here. This is a good reason to use a model. And one reason to do that, of course, if something changes over here, you don't care so much. So then not going to affect doing, but if there are changes here, you want to be very careful. Yes.
What's the different color of the picture? Like?
This is probably charge. Okay. I would assume, I don't know what float it is. What does it say? Yeah. Cytochrome C2. So now, it looks like I have a very strange charge distribution. So it's a very positive area in the middle, but I don't really know why.
So everything in the red in the picture is...
positive and everything blue is negative, I would guess. The white is probably non-charged, I would guess. That's my guess.
In hydrophobicity?
No, this is charged. Negative or positive, I think. You would never have this one. This is hydrophobic, definitely. And it might not be charged directly, it might be a Poisson-Boltzmann distribution of charges, I would guess. But that these things we'll do much more later in the third course this year. So you get this type of error plots. I don't know exactly what this actually means. This is some energy. So you can see some areas that maybe are high in energy, and you can suspect maybe these areas are areas, or in particular this area here, I guess, you should have an extra look at, maybe something wrong, maybe the model is not perfect. But they are, this is indications of things that go, they're not extremely, most of the things are not extremely useful for finding, but you can, I think, can you have, you really care about some areas. If you know that, the more you have indications that you should be more uncertain, it's not really make sure that it's so easy to make it better.
Those areas, are they calculated from bond constraints and
I don't know exactly what this is actually. This is Gromov's energies.
Right.
So it's some molecular mechanical energy. It really it's calculated from Van der Waals overlap, bond constraints, it's a chemical error.
Yeah.
And of course it's not at least it can be an indication. I mean there are reasons why it can be positive areas also. It could be an active site that has a binding, it can be a methyl ion missing or something like that. But it goes with the slightly bad impact the side chains on that. So it's more an indication of something bad than it's really it's a proof. A modeler, as I said, uses a very different approach, but it actually results very similar. So basically what Andre Sali did long time ago is that assume you have an alignment like that, and you have these two residues in this alignment, you have the G, D, and D, and this island is like this one, this island, this one, and they are in the structure somewhere. You can calculate the distance constraints. So you can say, how likely is that these two residues are from this one? Basically, most likely is that they are the same distance as they are here. So you can do this for every pair of residues, and every pair of atoms, actually. And if you two different templates, you can actually add these distances together. So you don't calculate the model, you can calculate all these parallel distances. Actually, you calculate the diagonal angles, things like that also, but basically parallel distances. And then you use these n squared distances. Like we talked about quantum prediction, but this is not quantum prediction, this is from an alignment. And you use these into a program that I'm sure that basically take all these and make a model. So it's I actually don't know what they use now. You use some distance geometry methods. I think you now this is basically some simulation annealing. So basically you run in a molecular dynamics simulation tool, high temperature, you turn off all the Van der Waals forces, the things that pass through, not at all chemical, but you do that and you cool it down slowly and turn on the forces and you get the model that looks quite okay. One thing that you lose in this case actually is the side chain orientations. So you have the constraints that are describing the side chains, but they are much better than just copying them.
Yeah, so could you go back to the slide with this way?
Yeah.
Yes. So because I'm not so sure from your video, I would like to ask, so we cannot, for example, taking this distance, we cannot use 20 because it's the it has the least frequency.
Yeah, so this is if you have two templates, for instance. So you have two alignments. So then take your query sequence here as some sequence, And you have template 1, T1 and T2. And maybe this is aligned to whatever. And so and you want to figure out the distance between that residue and that residue.
Mm-hmm.
So assuming that this distance, this distance is maybe 18 angstrom.
Yeah. And the other 24.
Yeah, another 24. It's a bit strange. But yeah. And then you have you from your big database that I train things on, they had all the if you have two alignments, one is 18 and one 24, what is the probability that this distance here is any number. So they have examples of the database. So of course, then you need to basically, in the database to have them, you can calculate the probability for a bit like that.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly how to formulate it, I don't really know, but in principle, it should be like that. So it's.
Right, so you will take that one and divide it by the overall area of the.
Assume that this one is more similar, this one is further away. Maybe we have a distribution that looks like that instead. So they have a number of parameters.
So it's also it has also dependent on their sequence identity.
Yeah, it uses a lot of statistical comparison. I mean, it basically has a lot of alignments and so forth, and it looks for observations. And then exactly what they do, I don't know. It's originally in a paper, there's a lot of data, but it's 20 years old, so I'm sure they've changed it. But basically, yeah, sequence identity, how far they saw it from groups of things in sequence, how far they from each other, how. Yeah, this is, etc. So it's just counting from lots of examples. Exactly how to group them together is a bit of a, you have to look at it. It's really original papers to do that.
So I have.
Okay.
But what does that frequency mean?
So frequency, this is just observations in the database somehow. So basically, then you calculate that. So from the database, I don't know how you have 10 to 60, but I guess you must have a lot of big databases. So they basically say that if I have seen this distribution, I mess the group things together. If I've seen these things, I would have observed this kind of frequency of that type and this kind of frequency of that type of this distance, and then they fit a curve to it. So they basically have, in this case, they fit two Gaussian curves together, because they need to have a continuous function that they use for their scoring later. So then basically, exactly what they must put a lot of examples together in this case. And of course, you have a lot of examples, every pair of residues are together somehow. But exactly how they group things together is probably a lot of optimization. But you probably will do quite well if you just copied all the things that were close. Because the distance are far away, it really doesn't carry any information, because they are probably going to be not very informative, but things that are close together are probably more or less enough to make the model. There's two papers here. I think this paper here. Yeah, three. It's a very thick paper with a lot of dots. And still, the amount of data they had there compared to now is nothing. It's probably 10,000 PV, but it's not 100,000, or even less.
So model, I think the model you're going to use in the lab for next week. And
it's actually, for simple purposes, it's very easy to use. What you have to do is somehow look at the results, because sometimes it doesn't convert, it doesn't make a nice model. But you often see that, because basically something that just have all the ends in all directions. Something maybe worth discussing is really how good are these models. So basically, if you take two PDB files, crystallography, you take the same sequence, exactly the same sequence, and you get two different crystal forms. So you know about crystallography, but that's the one way to get the crystal structure. So basically, and then the protist form and crystal form. So if you basically do two experiments and two and get this structure of the same sequence, they are basically on average with one Ångström away from each other. So one Ångström is the length of one bond in between nitrogen and oxygen. I mean, one bond is but one Ångström long. That's why we talk about Ångström, because we're in Sweden also. And basically, if you have something that is more than 56% identical, that's on the order of the same errors you have. So you are quite close to it. So unless you have something, it's very small details, you get something almost the same quality as you would have doing an experiment in slightly different conditions. Because basically vibrate. And then the vibrations, the fluctuations around a protein is in order of 1 to 2 Ångström. So basically, I mean, a stable protein, so fucking too much as 1 and 2 Ångström fluctuations. 2 Ångströms are close to the loops, and 1 Ångström more a bit less in the middle. So basically, if you have more than 50% than the number, you can be pretty sure. I mean, it might, of course, be details in hydrogen bonds on the network, if you think that you might get wrong, and that. There might be details that you really, if you really want to have exactly this hydrogen bond conserved, you might have get things wrong. But in principle, you can get the at least most of the structure going to look well, but very good. And then basically, if you go down to something like well, is model accuracy, you know, things like that. But now the 30% still have, sure, you start getting more arrows than you have in from two experimental structures. But you can see here, you have this loop here is not really perfect, there's some variation here, etc., etc. But just in the overall shape is the same. And then when you start going below, maybe 30%, okay, basically, in alignment with 30% things, then they're higher, you have hardened gaps. So the alignment is almost trivial. Very, very few gaps. That's basically when you start getting gaps. I mean, these can be exceptions, but in general, it's less than 30%, more than 30%, more than 50% are no gaps, 30% are some few gaps. But then the problem occurs when you get down here. You see that here you have to hold this whole loop, it's in the wrong position. So if you have a binding here, you're going to get completely wrong. This is longer, and you have to point the wrong way in other ways, either the end terminal or the terminal. So then you start getting a much, much bigger errors. And then, of course, what we talk about next week is basically when you go further down, you have oxygen, maybe a four oxygen way. Sure, they look a bit the same, but certainly you do not have the exact coordination of binding sites. So using this one, binding of small molecules is difficult at any level, but in particular, you may down here, basically, unless you have something extremely concerned, you're lucky, it's very, very hard, or almost impossible. Even here, you might start losing that, but up here, you can make a total good. But it's not always. In many cases, you couldn't even do a good virtual screen on the small molecules, even if they have the structure of the protein itself, but solved without the ligand bound. Because of course, the ligand chain structure, you could also. So if you were using the upper structure, you would not be able to dock it. So it depends on the binding site, how it looks like, how stable it is, how much it is, how flexible it is, if it's hydrophobic, etc. So on. So search for loops in database. So basically, I haven't read this paper in a long time, but basically what you do is basically you start with this. As I said, you start with this kind of, it's basically just finding three-dimensional, you have the position of these two and these two, so you have maybe four positions, and just go through all the PDB and find things that are in more than the same place and have five residues in between them. It's just the I mean, of course, you have a lot of arrows, but you just. I mean, PDB is not that big, and if you pick a fixed number, that needs to take a long time. I mean, you can pre-calculate most of it. So that's not. And then you will try the best hits, basically, put them in there. And you need to do some. You still need to do some optimization here around most. What is sidechain packaging? So that's a little bit about what Joanna talked about yesterday. So I put up a paper about this first in May on the yesterday lecture, and the problem is basically if you take a backbone of a protein and you know the sequence, can I rebuild the sidechains? Can I put the sidechains in the optimal position? And I said the best is to copy for template, but assuming you just have a backbone information and nothing else. And what people have found then is that basically you have this rota mesh it's the same as phi-psi angles in the backbone, but you have some particular positions that are more populated. So you have on the side chains, you have fixed rota mesh. Well, basically you normally have three, for each diagonal angle, you have three stable states. But for long side chain, of course, it's more. So you have a fixed number of rota mesh. And this rota mesh slightly depends on the backbone of that residue, but in particular, they depend on not colliding with anything else. So you have a super fan that can go in three positions like that. Of course, if there's another side chain over here, you're not going to be there. So then you're going to be in that position. So what people developed is, of course, basically, you can have algorithms that try all possible rota mesh from every side chain, and you try to find optimal ones. And if you do that, you're actually the core protein if your backbone is correct, you can basically get rebuild 80% of the core side chains perfectly. Because in the surface you have no information, you have no information there. You can't do anything there, but in the core you can build it quite a lot. And there was development of quite advanced methods using what's called dead end elimination theorems, basically. Right. If you want to search all possibilities that empty completes, you can't do that. But if you want to, there are some good upper heuristic algorithms that can find good solutions. And I think what Joanna said yesterday was that even people don't really care about finding the optimal alignment. Even if I one good solution, that's going to be 95% of the answer is the optimal one, that's fine enough. So basically the idea is that you basically take, you don't try continuous numbers, you try fixed root of measures, and you try to combine and find the best combination of them. And then in the core, if your background is correct, the core of protein is quite okay also.
Lost line, is it lost line? Well, so basically this is what there have been many methods developed just for this time to model how good the model is. And so I have this man, when you saw a plot from Swiss model was this Gromov's energies. So basically they're telling what part is good, what part is bad. And this was our first attempt, that was when it's been old nowadays, it was 2001. Well, we developed out this machine learning method called ProQ. We just published ProQ 3 last year, so we've been in some development. And so this, it basically builds an idea that, I mean, the difference between early methods is that we are actually trying to predict the quality of the model and not just trying to find the best, correct model from the decoys. So that's, and we use some machine learning methods, we use some dicussion approaches, etc. And we have, and 10,000 example models. Yes.
Can you explain a little bit more how surface area is related to the quality of protein?
So basically, if a model has, basically we know that the protein should, on average, have hydrophobic inside and hydrophilic outside. So surface area is per residue, so basically there are a lot of...
So should we minimize in that case?
So if you minimize the surface area of the hydrophobic residues and maximize the hydrophilic one. At least if you are completely wrong, I mean, this is not the only solution, but if you're completely wrong, you have a lot of hydrophobic residues on the surface, most likely the protein is wrong. Your model is wrong. And actually, what we do here is also actually what we do is that we compare the surface area of one residue here with the predicted surface area. So we have a machine learning method that you might have to do in next course, but that predicts the surface area. So basically, from looking at how the hydrophobic is, what else is around it, and evolutionary factors, etc. Just as we predict secondary structure, you can predict the surface area, and people can do that quite accurately. And then say, okay, if this is predicted to be in the inside, but it is actually outside, most likely our model is wrong. So basically, that's probably more, well, both of these information contains information. So surface area at low. So here basically we have, we have taken amino acid types and divided into different surface accessibility groups. So that is, and then we use that as an input network and particularly see if there's basically more or less 25% exposed to the water. It is a good measure.
Essentially, for those that the protons are very important, things like that. But is that a research field that's being developed very much lately, or?
Well, the protein.
The research of protein structure and.
Protein structure has been around since 1953, and it's certainly the research field that I give most Nobel prizes. At least it's, I think, 12 or 13 Nobel prizes for protein structure. So yeah.
So it's a rapid development.
Rapid. No, it's not as comparable to genome sequence, you know. It's developing, but it's not. It's been around. I wouldn't say it's rapidly increasing or developing, but it has become a very fundamental part of all biochemistry nowadays. I mean, without structure, you wouldn't. And it's has changed. So there are many, many more people doing protein structure work, but most people, very few people doing only protein structure work, that is. I mean, that's some, but most people do that as a part of their studies, because it's an important factor, but it's not the only thing. People are going to become more integrative. But it's, I mean, it was just deep soil structures was maybe 3 years ago or 4 years ago, some last of a prize for the structures. And I would be, and it was aquaporin, it was not that many years before. So even in the 2000s, there have been at least two Nobel Prizes, so not three, right? So also, at least three Nobel Prizes. I mean, all in chemistry, I think, for the structure. So it's only about a quarter of them. There's some other chemistry also. I don't think that if you look at biochemistry prizes and Nobel Prizes, well, you have GFP, you had some. Well, some is like microscopes, field is hydrogen microscopes. You have some mass spec, some speech. So there are some more methodological Nobel Prizes also that have been given. But I don't think really in pure. I mean, that's the two areas that have been in bio chemistry. And medicine, there are also other things that are not structure related. But it's a big part of it, but it's not, I wouldn't say it's rapidly growing, but it's because, you know, compared to genome sequencing, it's not. So homology modeling. No, so basically what I meant with that was that it's just the chemical factors, pure chemistry, bond length, bond angles, that's not a very good way of separating good and bad model. Because you can make a bad bond that's completely wrong and have nice chemistry. The hydrophobicity is more difficult, because you really need to put the hydrophobic esters on the outside. But you need to put bond length, bond angles, you might have some holes on it, but it's actually not that difficult, because that's not a good way of finding a bad model. So yeah, this one we, I think we went through this kind of the alignment loop thing. Yeah, so bad residue, bad chemistry. Basically, I mean, bad chemistry is really, bad bond angles, etc. I think yeah, this is probably the homology modeling benchmark. So this was our study that we did some years ago. I mean, the main point here is very much like it's actually not such a big difference. The methods are very similar. They're not identical, but they are, in general, you can use these are 5, 6, 7 different programs. And if you look at just RMC, so the errors in the positions of the atoms, the methods are surprisingly similar. This is the average for the number we made thousands of models, 10,000 models with these methods. And this is the for each this bin, so each bin here is like 55 to 66 density, and there's a standard deviation here, and basically all these lines are all on top of each other. It looks maybe like the one of the blue lines is slightly better on that, but it's a very, very small difference. And up here, it might be more shared than it's down here. So that basically says, any of the good methods you do, if you just look at the position of the atoms, it doesn't matter. I mean, in this case, you use the same alignment, of course, otherwise you can compare it. And you also can see that the sequence identity is kind of crucial, because, I mean, as I said, 50% sequence identity. If you're in the back, when you have 2 ohms to RMC. If you're under 30, you have 4 ohms to RMC, or 3.5. And here, if you got 1 ohms, when you have 8, 9, then you up to the quality or the experimental limits. I mean, more or less. But this is the backbone, and inside you have a bit more variation. And we saw something, this was a side chain, they said that this method here which is modular, it's always worse on the side. So this is the Tahira Angus, we wrote them, but the Kaiwan Kai 2, Tahira Angus. And these methods here are clear, but I think these were methods that actually copy the side chains. No, these are actually methods that you need to give, but these are methods actually that do not build the loops, so you only build the back ones, so they ignore the gaps. So at least one of them is clearly better here than here. This one. It's also really high, but more than it one, more than worse to be the side chains. The other methods are appear to be slightly better. But if you're down here, it's not a big difference, it's more here in your high energy.
And we actually think we have more than we rebuilt the side chain. It's just 3D EXO. No, okay, 3D EXO is bad. Modular.
That's a bit of work. All these red ones modular. And here that address is bad chemistry. There are methods that are made of crystallography that look at the chemistry of each residue. So it doesn't have an overlap, doesn't have good angles, and how many of these are bad. So the number of chemical parameters to calculate. And this is an account of the number of residues or the fraction of residues that are assigned to have a bad chemistry. So this is number of fractional bad residues. So 5% of all the residues in all these protein models are bad according to these cutoffs. So there's a program called mold probability that is used. There are two programs that people use doing that. But you can see clearly that this blue method, state model and CAD, is clearly better than anything else. In this aspect, but it was
not better in other aspects.
And these two methods are clearly worse. The modern method of the world, bad side also.
And this was some
kind of bad magazine together. But
there are some differences if you make this on average, but on the overall shape of protein is not a matter.
But if you really would like to make models, probably this thing could be good to do something that you want to do chemical chemistry. And the thing is that most cases you're interested in when you're difficult is when you're down here. And then it's many other aspects that are more important. I mean, it's particularly get the alignments right, and you have to maybe use several alignments and do that together. Because even here you have very few gaps, the alignment is quite easy.
I guess it's this slide you mentioned. This one?
Yes.
Yeah.
So maybe it was just compared on how well can model structures. So I think it's another slide for back. So basically, I said if you have 50, 60 density, basically the quality of a model is as good as you get with NMR or a low resolution crystallographic structure. It's close to what experimental limits. It's not the best experimental structures. There are, for some proteins, you have extremely good crystallographic structures that are below one ounce of the solution. You really see the high variance of every atom and on. This is, but many of them are not that good a solution. So really, these are, for most aspects, you can really do it. There are some docking problems you probably will have difficult, but you probably have difficult problems to do them also with. Even if you have a crystal structure, unless you have a crystal structure with the ligand bound. In this area here, of course, you basically look the same, you can understand the function very much of this, unless but you might have some hydrogen bonds, side chain, pack, or anything. And for docking, it would not probably be very useful. But if you want to understand, maybe this is interacting with something else, or it's the active size, and if this is important, just to mutate all these things, of course, very perfect. Here, I think it's very useful for many structures, but it really depends on the questions you're asking, it really depends on the protein. The people who wrote this, say for defining NMR structures, yeah, maybe you can do that for that. You can probably it's going to sort of take active sites in that. You can probably do a look at it. And you can maybe a certain do an annotation by function, but you probably can do with sequence nowadays also. But maybe not 99. So, it all boils down to the questions you want to answer. So, I mean, really, do you, particularly drug design, you need high resolution. If you just want to understand more, have a look at what function, what biological function, you need much less lower identity. But also, if you remember the talk of Björn Wallner, on the Monday, he talked about this one mutation that changes the function, and that is two residues that should be 30 away from each other to bind DNA, or 28 didn't bind. So it's one mutation here in the middle that made the flexibility much change different. And so this is something that, I mean, you could, it's a dynamic phenomena that you maybe get from simulation, but you will never get it from any experiments, because you will have trapped one solution. And just when you do homology modeling or anything else, the only way that get it is basically have a good model that did it and then try to simulate it. So that, in that case, is very, the model is as good as anything else. But certainly, I also talked to someone right just before lunch today, and there was a number of structures published by Nature and Cell the last few weeks, where the authors, my structures are probably okay, or at least more or less, but the authors didn't know anything about the chemistry or anything about functions. All the functional notations are completely wrong. They contradict 20 years of experimental data, so they just wrote something else that any expert in the field should know is wrong, and that's just, you can't take a structure in alone and understand anything of a protein. You need to have it in context of other data also. But if you do that, of course, you can explain a lot.
The funding of NMR structures, can we use artificial intelligence to do that for us?
I'm not really sure what it meant here, but I'm not sure really what you meant either. But
is it a refined animal structure where there was one picture of how the energy is in the structure, and then the molecule itself was in another part, and then you had to drag it to the energy part? If you, I can draw it on the board.
Sure. Well.
So this is the old body, and that was like, this is energy, and this is the side chain, and then she had to drag this part in here.
Okay.
Isn't this the NMR structure refining thing?
I don't think so.
I would think that instead of humans have to drag it here, can't we use artificial intelligence to do that for us?
That's probably refinement. I'm not sure if you're refining more structure. The problem is, of course, nobody is doing it as humans. Nothing that we do here is by humans. And it's always running a program that does something for us. And there has been a few like virtual reality things. There's actually a computer program I will show you next week called Folded, but you can try to do these things manually, but that's more for fun. It's quite a good tool for understanding for the structure. But what they do here, I see, NMR does is basically also define distance between atoms, but experimentally. So you find, you put the purified protein, you put it in an NMR sample, NMR tube, and you measure distance between spins, so basically either protons or carbon 13 or N15 or something like that. And they can measure the distances between, if they're close enough, you can find, it's called the nuclear overhead effect, you can find how far away, right, if they're close or not. So you will have lots of data on that atom is close to that atom. It's very close, as we're doing in contact relations, it's just that it's between atoms, you have many more of these examples. So it's very thin. So you can use basically the same methods as the model does that for modeling them. But of course, you have, so if you model it, this is the same idea basically in the refining process. So basically, you have this context, you go to here. But with different contexts and many more contexts. So, but of course, it can be areas of the sequence where you do not have enough coverage for some reason. To, if it's too flexible, you have a single business. And, or the other reasons also. But. So then you can maybe combine this with the more modeling to get better models. That, that's what we talk about. And this problem here, like moving sidechain, that's basically sidechain rebuilding. And that is what Joanna talked about. And that's so basically you have the problem that you have here, and you want to move here, you might have to retreat. So you couldn't like, and yet you can go over there, so basically have to rebuild everything once. And that's what you do with this. That's why it's root method, you try the combination. Unfortunately, but you try many combinations.
But change that they are not perfect, and that you always have to look at them yourself and then fix them. And I think that that you have to look at them yourself and fix them. But can't that part be done by an artificial intelligence?
Well, I think in my experience, I can never fix anything. So I think it's, I mean, generally, it's if you're an expert, you really know what you spend time on, you know what to look for, maybe your program's not tuned for it, and you can fix things. If you just spend a short time and not an expert, the computers are better than me at least.
I think in that example, she meant that the crystallographers build the models.
Yeah,
don't always put the sidechain
sure.
where the electron density is.
Yeah. No.
So therefore, if you want to do something, you have to win yourself.
Yeah. I mean, that's certainly, I mean, rebuilding. Building sidechains in crystallography is, building the map, going for the crystallography, the paradigm has, of course, the electron density map. So it's basically like a tubular thing later.
Yeah,
that's and that, of course, then you want to put your ball and stick model into that. And there are, of course, programs that help you, you don't do many, it's not like you do it, but that is still a process that people actually spend time doing, it's not completely automatic. There are tools that help you, but they are, I think it's not completely automatic yet. And that's probably you need, I don't know why, no, I mean, probably there's so much variation in each case, in other cases, it's difficult to make something that always work. And predictive cryptography, actually, there's the risk of building too much, because actually your density depends on your model. So if you start getting in the wrong place, you can actually enhance your errors. So you have to be very careful in that. Sure, computer programs will be able to handle that, but it's, I think it's, I mean, so, and you use computer programs for doing it. It's just that you want to check the process all the time. And I guess it's not enough data points to train from the automatically for people like it. But I mean, there are tools to help, but they're not perfect. And not truly the artificial intelligence, it's just refinement in bigger models and numbers. Okay, do we have any more questions or do you want to go to the lab?
Well, I just have a general question about homology modeling. I mean, sequences and structures are not always, there's not a big correlation between sequences and structures all the time, right? Your structure is more conserved than sequences. So if you're trying to always find the template, is that really always solid or is it possible to make predictions that is completely wrong based on homology?
There is, in general, there are also exceptions. There is a famous exception showing what is called the Jordan's protein, which can have one mutation, changes from being a beta C to an alpha helix. And the reason is not because actually that mutation changes, it's just that the protein seems to have two different stable states, one beta change, so basically you can probably change the state by changing pH on that also. So basically it's a middle stable protein. But of course, if you have a mutation that maybe more than the beta sheet protein, you have the beta sheet protein, and more than alpha, like you're going to have alpha one. So if you then test it against the other one, you're going to be completely wrong. But that's a bit of an exception, I would say. So there are cases like that. We have prion proteins that seem to have a stable structure and then falls from aggregates. so the ROs in. But as a good approximation, I think it's, and we have a paper we showed it, it's a surprisingly linear relationship between change of structure and sequence identity. It's not, I mean, there is a famous plot, I probably have somewhere here, but it's not, let's see if I can. Right, let's go to, what can it be? Let's cross the sequence. Yeah, but in this plot, if you look at this, is probably. This is a very, very famous plot that the people use on the virtual distance type. So you have sequence identity here, plotted one, well, this one is like that. And the arm is the, I don't know what measure is, but this is sequence identity. So basically, it's quite flat here and it goes up. If you have some kind of shape that looks a bit like. That's probably the backbone, I would imagine, but I don't really know. I mean, you have, this is another version of it. So you basically have some kind of stone here, say, okay, RST here, that's a friendly trend. But there are, if you look at the dark case here, it's very similar, but it's not the dark case here. It's probably that plot, it's actually not, that it probably has a sequence identity. That is not a very good measure, as you remember, because one mutation can happen, change another mutation can happen. So if you instead use distance of basically PAM matrix, PAM distance, so number of mutation use evolution distance, you get this plot. So this is the RST plot you had before, basically sequence identity, what is that? But if you take, I mean, at a super precise, on average it's a very linear change. And you can draw the measures in your case, but of course you can also see this large variation. Some proofs are much more stable with mutation, some proofs are less stable. So it's not that it all changes much, but on average it's quite a linear change. And of course, we know that one single point mutation can make a protein not stable. If it's a very important protein, that's in the middle of a protein, and you mutate something else, it's going to be, RST could be infinite because you can't fault. So it's a large, very noise there. But there probably are also some protein folds that are more stable and change less mutations because they are compact, the some that are more flexible.
And of course, there's also outliers on
the side. Yeah. So there are lots of outliers. But I mean, But on average, it's surprisingly straight line. Okay. Stop recording.